What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. I am very excited about this series, and in this first video, I want to start by answering two very important questions. Why do we use Docker, and what is Docker? Let's start with the why question, and suppose you're developing an application that is tightly dependent on several other pieces of software, like Node, MySQL, Redis, etc. So, this means you will have to install all these dependencies on your machine before attempting to run the application in question. On top of that, you will have to manage their versions, update them continuously, and make sure they're compatible between one another. And that's provided you need to run this single app and only this app on your machine. But what if you have several apps you need to run simultaneously and on different versions? What if you are doing parallel projects which require dependencies that cannot be installed and ran simultaneously? You see where I'm going. And this is a major headache every developer has to deal with at some point. Well, if you make use of Docker, you'll never have to worry about any of these again. As for every app you have, Docker creates an isolated environment holding a separate, isolated configuration that doesn't affect the configuration of the operating system or any other apps running concurrently on your machine. And all of this can be done with a single command at your terminal. And yes, this does mean that using Docker makes your application platform independent, and running your app via Docker on Linux, macOS, or Windows is not so different. And if you are still not impressed and excited, well, keep listening and I am sure you will be. Now, before diving in the details of the many other advantages of Docker, like rapid development and deployment, enhanced scalability and flexibility, higher security, etc., I want to try and tackle the what is Docker question. And while this question is a lot more challenging to answer, and each time someone refers to Docker, it might be they're kind of referring to an entire ecosystem of different projects, tools, and pieces of software. So if someone says I use Docker on my project, they might be referring to Docker Client or Docker Server. They might be referring to Docker Hub or Docker Compose. Again, these are all pieces of software that come together to form a platform or ecosystem around creating and running isolated environments called containers. So, your immediate question might be, well, what is a container? How are these environments created? And that's a good question, and we're going to try and answer it throughout this entire series. Okay, just a moment ago, I told you that by running some command at your terminal, Docker will ready an environment for our application. Well, that command is docker run. Now, before diving in the behind-the-scenes actions of this command, which we will do very closely in a moment, let's explore another very important piece of terminology. Most of the time, and we'll see why, when you run that command, something called the Docker CLI reaches out to something called the Docker Hub, and it downloads a single file called an image. An image is a single file containing all the dependencies and all the configuration required to run a very specific program. This single file gets stored on your hard drive, and at any point, Docker can use this image to create containers. So, a container is an instance of an image, and you can think of it as being like a running program. A program with its own isolated set of hardware resources, so it kind of has its own little space of memory, its own little space of networking technology, and its own little space of hard drive as well. Okay, I didn't really answer the question here of what Docker is, but we did learn at least that a reference to Docker is really talking about a whole collection of different projects and tools. And we also picked up two important pieces of terminology, a Docker image and a container. Now, these images and containers are the absolute backbone of what you and I are going to be working with throughout the rest of this series. Okay, it is now time to play around with Docker, and I don't want to spend time in this video showing you how to install Docker on your machine, because it's documented and very straightforward. So, I'll instead leave a link to the Docker docs in the card above, and let's dive right into it. I want to start by writing our very first kind of meaningful command with Docker CLI, and then we're going to go through a very specific flow of actions that occurred when that command got executed. We're going to write docker run hello-world. I'll then press enter, and we're going to see a lot of text appear very quickly on the screen. Now, you'll see a little hello message from Docker right here, and then you'll notice underneath that listed out a series of steps that just occurred when you ran that command. Let's dive deeper in each step. So, at the terminal, you and I executed the command docker run hello world. That started up the Docker client, or Docker CLI. Again, the Docker CLI oversees taking commands from you, kind of does a little bit of processing on them, and then communicates the commands over to something called the Docker server, and it's that Docker server that is really in charge of the heavy lifting. When we ran this command, it meant that you wanted to start up a new container using the image with the name of Hello World. The Hello World image has a tiny little program inside of it whose sole purpose is to print out the message that you see right here. And that's the only purpose of that image. Now, when we ran that command, it was issued over to the Docker server, and Docker server saw that we were trying to start up a new container using an image called Hello World. The first thing the Docker server did was check to see if it already had a copy on your personal machine of the Hello World image or Hello World file. Therefore, Docker server investigated something called the image cache. Now, because you and I just installed Docker on our personal computers, that image cache is currently empty. We have no images that have already been downloaded before. So, because the image cache was empty, the Docker server decided to reach out to a free service called Docker Hub. The Docker Hub is a repository of free public images that you can freely download and run on your personal computer. So, the server reached out to Docker Hub and said, "Hey, I'm looking for an image called Hello World. Do you have one?" Of course, the Docker Hub does, so the server downloaded this Hello World file and stored it in our personal computer. It stored it in this image cache, where it can now be rerun at any point in the future very quickly without having to be redownloaded from the hub. So, we downloaded it, and after that the Docker server said, "Great, I've got this image now, and it's time to use it to create a container." So the Docker server took that single file, loaded it up into memory, created a container out of it, and then ran a single program inside of that container, and that program's purpose was to print out the message you see in front of you, and that's pretty much it. That's what happens when you run this Docker command. It reaches out to Docker Hub, it grabs the image, and then it creates a container out of that image. Now, one thing that you'll notice that's kind of interesting is if we run the Docker run hello world command a second time, you'll notice that we are not going to see the message of downloading the image or the one saying image not found locally like the first time. And that is because we already downloaded it to our image cache on our personal computer. So the big lesson here is that the first time you try to make use of any of these public images, you're going to have to download it. But then in the future, after that, you can start up a container using that image much more quickly because the image has already been downloaded to your computer. Okay, after going through all this, we're still surprisingly light on some of the details around exactly what a container is. So, in the next video of this series, we're going to give you a detailed behind-the-scenes look at what a container is exactly and how it is created on your machine. Stay tuned! That's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.